Hello everyone, welcome to the second month of our online training course. In module 11, we are going to discuss something that is very contemporary in this pandemic, the management of neonatal COVID-19 infections. The mentoring team for this includes Dr. Murali Raj N, Dr. Binish Balachandran and Dr. Rojo Joy from Kerala. I welcome all of you for this module as well. Friends, in the next 1 month's schedule, which has been published already, there are two live sessions. The first of the live sessions is going to be on 27th October, that is during this module 11, on Tuesday at 7:30 p.m., an international webinar on the same topic, COVID-19 and you. It is basically your well-being, resilience and safety that is going to be discussed during this webinar. I cordially invite all of you to attend this webinar as well in either Zoom or in YouTube Live. Now let's get on with module 11. I invite the first speaker for the lecture series, Dr. Murali Raj, to initiate his talk. Thank you.
Hi friends, welcome to the 11th module of the Nurses Training Session organized by NNF Kerala, NNF Pathanamthitta and National Neonatology Forum India. From today, for the next 3 days, we'll be discussing probably a new disease, a disease which is very prevalent all over the world and yet very less known to the human community. Yes, I am speaking about the COVID-19. We know that since December 2019, we have been overwhelmed with this global pandemic. And very little is known about this virus, its transmission, and other pathophysiological process. So the next 3 days, we will be discussing about perinatal transmission and neonatal coronavirus infection. Myself and Dr. Binish Balachandran from Malappuram and Dr. Rojo Joy from Kochi will be discussing various aspects about the neonatal coronavirus infection. So today I will be discussing about the certain definitions, the issue, the disease process of coronavirus in newborns, the risk of vertical transmission, the care of the mother, and also the immediate care of the baby in the delivery room. Today's definite topic is delivery room management and the initial stabilization. I'll be dealing with these under these headings: introduction, the risk of perinatal transmission or postnatal transmission, what is the problem of COVID-19, then various protocols that we have, practical issues and confusions, because since it is a new disease and little is known about this disease, there will always be confusions, there will always be change of protocols, and different countries, different regions, different institutions will have their own protocols. So as you know, this coronavirus first was reported in 2019 December in China, and after about 3 months, in March 11, 2020, WHO declared the outbreak as a public health emergency of international concern. And after that, about 8 or 9 months, we are seeing the different ups and downs in each and every part of the country. So this is the latest data of the WHO. We can see that United States tops the list and second one is India. And globally, there is about 41 crores of people are affected and about 11 lakhs people are died due to this coronavirus infection. And another interesting thing about the WHO data is that WHO doesn't say that the community transmission has already been happen in India. It says that India is having clusters of cases, but in United States, is they are already documented that community transmission has already been occurred. So whatever the case is, the problems of children and mothers are varied. There is a clear-cut difference in the morbidity and lack of education or access to proper education and healthcare services in the pre-COVID and the post-COVID time. As correctly mentioned by UNICEF in 2020, approximately 150 million of additional children are living in multi-dimensional poverty without access to essential services. As you can see that pre-COVID times, the issue was 47%, and in the post-COVID time, it is about 56%. And in the COVID times, an additional 1.2 million children and 57,700 mothers could die in 6 months due to disruption of basic interventions based on the worst-case scenario. So it is definitely a public health problem. Even if the newborns and newborn babies didn't get infected with the COVID, or even if they didn't die due to COVID, they can have the issues related to the socioeconomic, cultural, and other factors related to COVID-19 infections. So it's a question, can pregnant women pass coronavirus to the unborn children? The evidence is not so strong, and at this time there is not much evidence to determine whether the virus is transmitted from the mother to have a baby during pregnancy or the potential impact of this on the baby. But it is being currently investigated. And as we don't have any data or any evidence to say that vertical transmission will not occur, so the pregnant women should continue to follow the appropriate precautions to protect themselves from exposure to the virus and seek medical care early if experiencing symptoms such as fever, cough, or breathing difficulty. So this is the UNICEF recommendation, and we know that the absence of evidence is not the evidence of absence. So what are the possible routes of transmission from the mother to the baby? Let's say antenatally through placenta, during delivery and postnatally by environmental exposure, and breast milk. We don't know whether it is transmitted through breast milk or not, but there is till now there is no clear-cut evidence to say that it is transmitted through breast milk. So this is one of the picture which is taken from one of the latest publications. Of all the reported neonatal COVID infections, you can see that about 70% of infection have occurred in the postpartum period, that is in the postnatal period. And about 30% have occurred, or the virus is transmitted at the antenatal time or at the time of delivery. So you can clearly you can see that they have not mentioned it is a definite postpartum acquired infection. Probably it can be a probable postpartum acquired infection. And also in this area, also majority of the annotations are probable. We don't know what is a specific route, but we assume that it can be a prenatal or a postnatal thing. So what is the vertical transmission? Vertical transmission, the definition is the mother is positive for COVID-19 between 14 days prior to birth and 2 days after birth. That is 2 weeks prior to birth and 2 days after birth if the mother is positive. And the virus should be detected in neonatal nasopharyngeal swab within 24 hours of life. An amniotic fluid, umbilical cord blood, or a neonatal sample within 24 hours of life. So there must be an evidence for maternal infection, and the virus should be detected in the baby also. World over, that says that about 2% of infants born to COVID positive women are tested positive. They do have higher risk for respiratory stress and low birth weight. Clinical features like poor feeding, diarrhea, fever, and feed intolerance can be there. Late onset sepsis, leukopenia, lymphopenia, neutropenia, and thrombocytosis, ground glass infiltrates in chest X-ray are reported. But any of these clinical features or investigation findings are not specific to COVID-19 infection. Any baby with a bacterial sepsis can also have these type of findings. We have a full session on the ICU care of COVID positive babies coming up the next day. So I'm not going into detail of that. So what is a confirmed case of COVID-19 infection? Neonatal COVID infection, that is nothing but an RT-PCR positive. What is suspected? That is a history of exposure. Mother has COVID-19 infection less than 14 days of birth, that I already mentioned, less than within 2 weeks of birth, and a history or a history of contact with the COVID-19 positive patients in the postnatal period. Then even if there is no history of exposure, if the child or if the newborn presents with the SARI, that is severe acute respiratory infection, at second or third or fourth day of life, and that clinical features cannot be explained by any other diseases. So it is presenting with pneumonia or SARI requiring hospitalization, onset more than 48 or 72 hours of age, unless there is another underlying illness that is completely explains the respiratory signs or symptoms. What is severe acute respiratory infection? That is respiratory distress with a cough or fever. So in these times when different authorities say that community transmission has already occurred in our community, any infant, any newborn presenting with this respiratory infection after second or third day of life, which cannot be explained by any other means, can be taken as a COVID-19, can be suspected to have COVID-19 infection, and adequate testing should be done accordingly. Now we come to the antenatal monitoring of mothers. Do the COVID-19 infection, or does the COVID-19 infection have any impact on the antenatal care and mode of delivery? The answer is a no. The mode of delivery in a pregnant woman infected with the COVID-19 should be guided by the obstetric assessment and her physiological stability. COVID-19 infection itself is not an indication for inductional labor or operative delivery. Fetus should be continuously monitored, CTG monitoring should be done, and electronic monitoring is not available. A manual monitoring by frequent auscultation of the fetal heart rate should be done. So, just because the baby, the mother is infected with the COVID-19, it doesn't change the obstetric protocols. Then adequate equipment and trained healthcare providers should be available for intrapartum monitoring and obstetric interventions, as indicated in the separate childbirth facilities for infected pregnant women. Continuously oxygenation should be monitored, and if the SpO2 goes below 94%, oxygen therapy should be given to the mother. Coming to the preparation of the resuscitation area. The thing is that all people who are involved in the care of the baby and also in the resuscitation should wear full PPE, that is personal protective equipment. I'll come to that later. If you're cleaning the area, if it is visibly soiled, that is blood is there, dirt is there, clean with soap and water before applying the disinfectant. What all things can, what all chemical agents can we use? That is 0.5% of sodium hypochlorite solution can be used to disinfect larger surfaces like floors and walls. It should be done at least one time per shift. That is, if you have 3 shifts per day, it should be done 3 times a day. 70% of the alcohol can be used to disinfect small areas between users and reusable equipments. Then hydrogen peroxide, 10% volume by volume solution. That is, you mix 100 ml of hydrogen peroxide into 900 ml of distilled water to make a total of 1 liter. It can be used for cleaning incubators, warmers, infusion pumps, water therapy units, etc. The issue of hydrogen peroxide is that you should anticipate and use it, because the contact period of hydrogen peroxide to any surface is minimum 1 hour. So may not be possible in the case of acute emergencies, but any planned operative delivery or other things, you can plan and anticipate and use hydrogen peroxide for disinfection. What are the personal protective equipments that you should use? The respiratory protection, you should look at triple layered surgical mask. And if you are doing aerosol generating procedures, you should use an N95 mask. What are aerosol generating procedures? I'll come to that in the subsequent slide. And there should be an adequate seal. Even if you wear an N95 mask, there can be air which is coming out, and you can, when you breathe, it will be coming in through this side of the nerves. So you can fix a layer of micropore or other adhesive plasters to make an adequate seal. For eye protection, you should use goggles or face shields. Body protection, you should use long-sleeved water-resistant gown. And hand protection, you should use gloves. One of the most important slides, that is the running and doffing of PPE. I'm not going to show the videos, but the different types of different protocols of donning and doffing of PPE is available in the YouTube. And these two links are taken from the WHO. And your hospital is having your own protocols, your own videos. Now everybody are getting keen in making videos and posting in the social media. So your hospital also might have made a video for watching the healthcare professionals. Then coming to the preparation of the resuscitation room, it is always desirable to have a physically separate adjacent room. If you want to resuscitate the baby, it is preferable that you don't do it in the delivery room or the OT itself. Do have a separate room. If there is no physical separation, that is, you don't have a separate room, keep the resuscitation warmer 2 meters away from the delivery cot. Put a curtain in between the two areas. You can use a closed system like an incubator. You can use a giraffe type incubator you can use. Or you can use a transport incubator. Then how many persons should be there? That is, a person should be minimum. That is, one in low risk areas and two in high risk areas. Another important thing is that as you reduce the number of staff, reduce the number of healthcare workers in the OT or theater as minimum as possible, because that will reduce the risk of exposure. All people should wear full set of PPE, N95 mask, suit, face shields, and goggles. Delivery room member to bring the neonate to the warmer. Then mother, hand hygiene. The delivery lady should have adequate hand hygiene, and a triple layer surgical mask should be worn by her. This is one of the slides which is prepared by one of the doyens of pediatrics and neonatology, that is Professor Satyen Lakshminarayan Sinha. This slide clearly depicts what all things that you can do in the delivery room. So first thing that pregnant women should be, or part of the visitor should be, screened. That I am pretty sure that every hospital is doing that. Then in the operative room, One thing is a negative pressure room. In majority of the corporate hospitals or high income countries, they will have separate labor rooms or OTs with the negative pressure rooms. But majority of the Indian hospitals are not having it. So what we can do? We can put 2 to 3 exhaust fans and make the air blow out. So it will act as some sort of a negative pressure room. Then the lady should wear a mask, that is I already mentioned. Then N95 mask should be wear if aerosolization procedures are likely, like intubation or bag and mask ventilation. Minimum number of providers in the room, PPV, that already I have already mentioned. This protocol doesn't recommend a skin-to-skin contact, but there is some change in our protocol that will come to that later. Then delayed cord clamping can be done in the labor room. So this is the delivery area, and this is the baby resuscitation area. So this is a transport isolate, that is a closed system with the self-inflating bag, resuscitation equipment, and the person who is well versed in neonatal resuscitation, and additional providers outside the room for backup. So this gives you an outline about what to do when a delivery or a cesarean section is imminent in case of a COVID positive mother. So 2-3 times I have mentioned about aerosol generating procedure. What are aerosol generating procedures? Anything that generates aerosol is aerosol generating procedure, isn't it? So intubation, extubation, manual ventilation, suctioning, tracheostomy, upper airway procedures that involve suction, open suctioning of the upper respiratory tract. If you give NIV, BiPAP, CPAP, or high frequency oscillatory ventilation, or even if you use a TPS resuscitation, that is also highly aerosol generating. And if you are using an oxygen flow at more than 2 liters per minute, it is a aerosol generating procedure. HFNC and nebulization, all these are aerosol generating procedure. If you are doing an aerosol procedure, or the baby is undergoing treatment with NIV or BiPAP or HFO or HFNC, you should wear, definitely you should use the N95 mask and the full personal protective equipments. So there should be a predetermined protocol for the baby flow and the staff flow from the labor room or the OT to the NICU. We will see what will happen. The baby, I already mentioned about the delivery room. There should be a staff to receive the baby. There will be one nursing staff to assist the gynecologist or whoever doctor who is doing the procedure. Another staff, that is a staff number one, will wait there to take the baby. She will not take part in the operative procedures or other assisting work. So this staff will receive the baby and take the baby to the resuscitation area. So this staff two will take the baby from the labor room to the resuscitation area and hand over the baby to staff three. Then after resuscitation, the staff three will hand over the baby to staff four, nursing staff healthcare worker four, and that healthcare worker will shift the baby to NICU. Usually in case of where what happens usually is that a nursing staff who is there in the labor room will take the baby to the resuscitation area, and she will do the resuscitation, and sometimes she will transport the baby to NICU also. So that things is not recommended if the mother is COVID positive. there should be a designated person who transports baby from the OT or labor room to the resuscitation area, from the resuscitation area to the NICU, and at the resuscitation area, there should be adequate staff. So the staff should be having predefined and well-briefed roles, no exchange or crossover duties, and all should wear adequate personal protective equipments. So while doing the near to resuscitation, there is not much change. You have to follow the standard NRP 2015 algorithm. I am pretty sure that your module on NRP 2015 is already over, so I am not going into that. You have to follow the same standard procedures. So already mentioned that we follow the standard resuscitation protocol, that is NRP guidelines. And the important thing is that if positive partial ventilation is required, use a self-inflating ambu bag rather than a TPS resuscitation. And always remember that resuscitation is an aerosol generating procedure. Why TPS is not recommended? Because TPS is more aerosol generating. Disinfection of TPS can be an issue after use because it is some complicated to dismantle and disinfect it. And I'm pretty sure that many of the teams will be more familiar with a self-inflating bag rather than a TPS. So under the condition of stress, you are using a device which is not familiar to you, will not be good. So hence, self-inflating bag is recommended for providing positive pressure ventilation. As I already mentioned, that in end of Kerala, for stable babies, delayed cord clamping, we recommend delayed cord clamping because the initial recommendations which were formulated at the beginning of COVID-19 outbreak, that is March or April, delayed cord clamping was not recommended. Now we know that the benefits of delayed cord clamping will outweigh the risk of COVID-19 transmission because there is scanty evidence that COVID-19 transmits through the time that of 1 minute, 1 minute time that virus transmits through the umbilical cord. So you can do delayed cord clamping. Then skin to skin contact at the delivery room can be done, provided the mother is already washed her hands, put a glove, and she has already worn a triple layer surgical mask. Yes, you can do a skin to skin contact at the delivery room, and you can breastfeed also the baby. So you practice delayed cord clamping, skin to skin contact at delivery room, and you can initiate breastfeeding also it for stable babies in the immediate postpartum period. Don't forget about the parents and families who are waiting outside the labor room or OT. They should be given periodic update about the health condition of the mother and the baby if the baby is admitted in the NICU. But you should screen them. Visitors of both routine and COVID-19 specific childbirth neonatal areas should be screened for symptoms of COVID-19 infection. I am pretty sure that everybody are doing that. For neonates roomed in with the mother with suspect or confirmed COVID-19 infection, one healthy family member following contact and droplet precautions should be allowed to stay with her to assist baby care and activities. So you'll know that it will be very difficult in the immediate postpartum period for the mother to handle her baby. So a person with a screened person with the full protection should be allowed to stay with the mother to assist her. After neonatal resuscitation, after the baby is being handed over to the NICU, another important thing is that doffing. The team should doff the PPE or exit in the delivery area at a designated doffing areas. And all the PPE should be disposed as per the disposing policy and perform hand hygiene. So waste disposal should be done, the waste handling, segregation, transport, and final disposal should be as per the protocol which is described by the Government of India. What will you do the resuscitation equipments if you suppose you expect all type of complications, you were ready for accepting a baby who you expected the baby to be very sick, the baby was very active. So you have set all the PPV, you have set all the equipments. What do you do for the next delivery? You have to discard that. You should take a new set for each delivery. If you are using disposables like ET tube, OG, suction catheters, or syringes, that should be discarded even if unused. Reusable equipments such as laryngoscope, all those things, should be thoroughly disinfected as per the hospital policy. You should wear personal protective equipments while dealing with the contaminated equipments. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Dr. Binesh Balachandran. We will today discuss about how we can manage a newborn baby who is admitted in NICU with COVID. As we know, the risk of COVID-19 to a newborn is less when compared to an adult. It has been seen that even those mothers who are positive for COVID, even their newborns, the risk of acquiring of infection is around 2% only. And even among those newborns who are acquired infection, majority are asymptomatic. Though a COVID infection in pregnancy put the mother at high risk of preterm delivery and also the newborn at higher risk of respiratory distress syndrome, as I already said, majority of these babies are asymptomatic. And even when clinical features happens, most of the time these are minor symptoms, something like diarrhea, a mild diarrhea, poor feeding, or other mild gastrointestinal symptoms. Very rarely only these babies develop some severe symptoms, something like sepsis, fever, leukopenia, lymphopenia, neutropenia, and thrombocytosis, or even a ground glass infiltrating X-ray. These are relatively rare. Mind you, most of these babies, especially in the early part of the infection, your pro-inflammatory cytokines, the things that your procalcitonin or C-reactive protein or CRP, are likely to be negative, especially in the initial stage of the illness. So the outcome is relatively good in newborn when compared to adult. Even if the newborn is symptomatic, generally the symptoms resolve within 24 hours of after onset. The symptoms per se starts around 5 to 6 days after the infection, and these symptoms, as I already said, are pretty transient, and some minor symptoms like poor feeding, etc., may persist for 1 to 2 weeks. Though fecal viral shedding has been shown to persist for few weeks, the significance of this is not known. How we test a newborn? We test by nasopharyngeal swab. RT-PCR is the gold standard, but we can use the TrueNAT or CBNAT, etc., as equivalent that of RT-PCR in most of the practical setting. It is now, there is a consensus that in an asymptomatic newborn, probably doing multiple tests is probably not warranted, and we can probably do away with single test, which is done on day 5 or pre-discharge, whichever is later. But in any baby who is admitted in NICU, irrespective of the exposure or the mother's COVID status, if the child develops severe acute respiratory illness or pneumonia after 24 hours of age, or the child has acute respiratory illness which is otherwise you cannot find the cause or you cannot attribute to any obvious cause, all these babies should be tested. Likewise, any GI symptoms which is otherwise unexplained, you need to test the baby. In those babies, you do the test immediately, and if the test found to be positive, you may have to repeat it a few times before saying that the baby has been cleared of infection. I know this may be a repetition from the initial modules, but just to emphasize the fact, the COVID-19 or coronavirus the transmission rate is high through aerosol generating procedure or through aerosols. So we should all be worried about the aerosol generating procedures. The common ones are highlighted in red that we generally do in NICU, like intubation, extubation, manual ventilation, open suctioning of respiratory tract, your respiratory support modalities like non-invasive ventilation, BiPAP, CPAP, high frequency ventilation, or any oxygen supplementation which is at a flow rate of more than 2 liter per minute, or especially in high flow nasal cannula, etc., and also nebulization. So these are aerosol generating procedures, so we should take extra care as a healthcare worker while providing these procedures. Again, the PPE, the personal protection equipment that we should be using, is again probably a repetition, but just to emphasize, if you are working in an NICU which has COVID positive in newborns, you should be using a full PPE kit that includes a gown, two gloves, an N95 mask, the goggles, face shield, apron, and boot cover, etc., etc. At the current setting, wherever you work in the hospital, irrespective of it is a COVID care area or non-COVID care area, you should always be using a minimum of one surgical mask, and likewise, the NICU, ideally the NICU has some specifications, should need some specification to make it suitable for admission of COVID positive newborns. Ideally, if you have the facility, it should be a adequately ventilated single rooms, especially with negative pressure, and there are some air change criteria also, but most of the units in our country do not have this luxury of single rooms ICUs or those with negative pressure. So we can even convert a routine care area into a negative pressure some way by a crude negative pressure by putting 3 to 4 standard size exhaust fans or a larger 2 exhaust fans in the unit. So that's maybe something that is very practically feasible for most of the units in our country. These rooms can have standalone air conditioner. The only thing that preferably this area should not be a part of central air conditioning, but a standalone air conditioner is perfectly fine. If you have enough isolation facility, you separate the suspected and confirmed cases, but in the current setting, most the suspected category is probably not relevant. It's either tested positive or tested negative. But anyway, if you don't have adequate isolation facility, you can care in same area, but there should be adequate distance between two beds. Incubators are preferred if you have it, but if you are using open care, also again, most ensure that the two beds have minimum of 2 meters distance in between. The respiratory support, what respiratory support we can use? We can use all the respiratory support that is indicated in a newborn, like our previous routine protocols. But if you have a choice, preferably use CPAP instead of non-invasive IPPP, non-invasive invasive ventilation, or high flow nasal cannula. So NAPPV and HFNC are at least theoretically have higher propensity to generate aerosols. So if you have a choice, you can probably prefer CPAP. And while using CPAP, use a lowest flow that is possible. And if you have multiple CPAP modalities in your unit, probably a ventilator CPAP may be better practically than a bubble CPAP. But if you don't have ventilator CPAP, bubble CPAP you can perfectly use. This is because in a ventilator CPAP, you have got a separate expiratory limb which can be connected to a bacterial filter. So at least theoretically it has some advantage, but for practical purposes, you use what you have in facility. If you have a choice, then obviously prefer CPAP, and in among them it is dual limb or ventilator CPAP. And whenever you use a ventilator or whenever it is possible, attach a bacterial filter at the expiratory limb. If you have a HEPA filter, that is perfect. But if you don't have HEPA filter, use just a routine bacterial filter, which will at least filter out most of the aerosols. And again, use the lowest possible PEEP to achieve the targets of your ventilation. If it is available, you can use an aerosol box with pot covered using a surgical mask or other ways. I will show you how aerosol box look like, something like a bigger oxygen hood or head box oxygen. If the intubation is needed, just follow the routine protocols, but ideally a more experienced person should intubate, because to avoid multiple trials, and all the persons who are attending the intubation should use proper PPE, including N95 mask. The intubation box or aerosol box is something like that. It has got, probably it will prevent aerosol dissipation to some extent. So if you have it, you can use it. About breastfeeding, again, it may be a repetition, but we should always remember that the benefits of breastfeeding hugely outweigh any risk of COVID-19 transmission. So we should all actively promote breastfeeding, even if the baby is COVID positive. The same with skin-to-skin care or kangaroo mother care. It should be promoted like the previous as a routine protocol. But obviously, if the baby is in NICU and the mother is sick and COVID positive, as she cannot visit the baby in NICU, there may be practical problems. But whenever it is possible, whenever it is feasible, you should continue with kangaroo mother care. NICU visit policy, for obvious reasons, the mothers or their partners who are COVID-19 positive are generally avoided or should be avoided entering the NICUs until their status is resolved. And whenever a mother gives hands-on care to the baby, she should use a mask and hand hygiene until the infectivity period is over. That is generally up till 10 days from the symptom onset or test positivity. But if the mother is too sick or immunocompromised, this 10-day period is extended to 20 days. About the specific treatment in for COVID-positive babies in NICU, the drugs that is used in adults like hydroxychloroquine, antiviral, steroid, IVIG, plasma therapy, etc. doesn't have a proven role in NICU, so these are not used routinely. We generally give only supportive care, but in rare conditions, you can discuss with the experts and individualize the treatment. Disinfection of the NICU is more important as a nursing care practice. Fortunately, the coronavirus is very labile, so almost all the routine disinfectants that you use in NICU is good enough for removal of coronavirus. So rather than changing the agent that you're using, what you should concentrate is to ensure that disinfection is being done routinely. So that's the only thing that is needed, because even a soap and water may clear the coronavirus. So we should ensure that the person who is disinfecting or cleaning should wear a PPE kit, full PPE kit. And those equipments which are soiled should be cleaned with soap and water before disinfection for obvious purpose, like your routine disinfectant like sodium hypochlorite, which is very cheap, is good enough against corona. So all your floors and walls should be cleaned as the routine protocol, and if possible per shift. You can use 70% alcohol for small areas or reusable equipments. Hydrogen peroxide is again a good disinfectant, especially for the surface cleaning of intubators, warmers, infusion pumps, pain scales, ventilator, monitor, phototherapy units and shelves, etc. But remember, the hydrogen peroxide cannot be used when the baby is already in the incubator on open care. So in between patient care only it can be used. Otherwise, you had to use other routine disinfectant. So the important thing about disinfection is not that you need to use any fancy disinfectant. You can use what is available to you, and what is most of the disinfectants already said will clear out the coronavirus. The thing that you should stress is to follow the disinfection as a routine and as per the recommended protocol. So that's the only thing that I have to convey regarding the COVID-19 baby in NICU. So we should remember that it is almost, we all can effectively treat a newborn with COVID-19. Why? Because these babies require only supportive treatment. No fancy regimens, no fancy treatments, etc. are needed in most of the time. The low infectivity, that what I mean about that, the risk of a healthcare worker acquiring a COVID-19 from a baby in NICU is very, very low, practically negligible, provided you use your PPE equipments, especially N95 mask. In fact, I can say that in our current situation, if you use a proper recommended PPE, a COVID NICU may be the safest place for you rather than community or anywhere else in the hospital. And these babies are unlikely to have any complication. Most of the babies recover very well. So that's in nutshell about the COVID-19, and I think we should all be confident and hopeful in treating these babies. Again, you are welcome to for any other practical questions and comments in the Telegram group. As a question analysis, we will clear out the try to clear the doubts. So that's about for today. Thank you so much.